Second and fourth speaker. I'm looking.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, good morning, everyone. How are you doing? Good? Okay, I hope they can hear me outside. So my name is Dina Papayanaki, and I work for Google, as you can clearly see. Welcome to the data center networking session. So I'm actually missing the last speaker, which is not tragic because they are the last, but still, it would be good to have them at the front. Dingming, you want to come up? So we are going to start this session with Dingming Wu. He's a fourth-year PhD student at Rice University. And please go ahead.
Thank you, Dina. Good morning. I'm Dingming Wu from Rice University. Today I'll be talking about how to mask network failures from application performance in data centers. So our solution is called Shared Backup. It is mainly about how to use backup switches in the network so that it can provide fast and transparent failure recovery. And this work is a joint work with my colleagues from Rice University and Facebook. So data center networks should be reliable and provide consistent high bandwidth for server communications. But due to the huge scale, network failures are actually inevitable. So when these network failures occur, they cause a disruptive effect to the applications. So last month, a Google Cloud outage is triggered by networking issues, and it caused tens of services to become unavailable, including those popular ones such as Spotify and Snapchat. And for another example, a big network outage earlier caused Amazon.com become unavailable, and people have estimated that the average cost of this downtime is over $200,000. And this is also shown in academic papers. So the paper's failure study on a Microsoft data center shows that for the median case of failures, about 10% of net traffic is delivered. And for the worst 20% of failures, 40% of net traffic is delivered. So how to handle these failures in networks? Today, people have developed different types of rerouting solutions. So we show in this picture an example of how do they perform rerouting. So we have a red flow and we have a green flow. And originally, these two flows do not share a path with each other. So they both enjoy line rate throughput. And if there's a link failure on the downward path of the red flow, then we can do a fast local rerouting as a way it's done in F10. So this will cause inflated path length. As shown in the example, the red flow will need to travel more hops to reach the destination. And we can also do optimal global rerouting as the solution proposed by Portland. In that case, the red flow still travels through the shortest path, but this will cause high latency of route updates, because whenever there's a failure, the controller needs to update switch routes, and that will cause high latency. And beyond that, rerouting also impacts flows that are originally not traveling through the failure location. So in our case, the green flow doesn't travel through the failed link, but still, it will experience degraded throughput because of bandwidth contention from rerouted flows. And to quantify this impact, we also run the simulation results using the Facebook CoFlow trace on a K equals 16 factory network. And we use global optimal rerouting to recover from failures. And from this figure, we show that for 1% of link failure, about more than 10% of flows will be impacted. And if we look at the CoFlow level, shown in the blue lines, about 40% of CoFlows will be impacted. So we want to ask, do we have any other options? So we want a solution that can immediately restore the bandwidth after failures. And if we use backup switches, then we want to keep the backup switch small and be cost effective. So the question is then, how can we achieve that? And this is through circuit switches. So here we introduce some background on circuit switches. Circuit switches are the passive physical layer devices. And this graph shows a circuit switch with four ports connect to A, B, C, D, four regular switches. So we can, with this straightforward connection, A is connected to C, and B is connected to D. And we can also flip links so that A is connected to D, and B is connected to C. So all this circuit configuration is done by software, and can be done in very fast speed. Examples about this circuit switch include an optical 2D MEMS switch that can switch at a speed of 40 microseconds and the cost is about $10 per port. Another example is an electrical cross point switch. It can switch in 70 nanoseconds and the per port cost is only $3. So before we introduce the architectural shared backup, let's think of, well, what's the ideal way of using backup using this circuit switching? So we envision that if we have one giant circuit switch, then we can connect all the regular switch and backup switch and the servers to this single circuit switch. In that case, we then enable the entire network to share one single backup, and any failed switch can be replaced by the backup at the runtime. But this is infeasible because it requires unreasonable high port count of circuit switch. And also the circuit switch will become a single point of failure. So then how to make it practical? We show that to support feasibility, we must use many small port count circuit switches instead of one giant big circuit switch. And to scale up the network, we need to partition network into failure groups and distribute circuit switch across the entire network. And we also want to achieve low cost, so we should keep the backup switch pool very small, and we share the backup switch per failure groups. So here we introduced some details about shared backup architecture. We use the, so shared backup is built on top of the existing fair tree network. And here we show an example of the K equals 6 fair tree, which means that switch port count is 6. And there are three layers here, the edge layer, the aggregation layer, and the core layer. So the edge switches and the aggregation switches are organized into 6 ports. And each port has 3 edge switches and 3 aggregation switches. So on top of this topology, we partition the switches into failure groups. Each failure group has K over 2, which is 3 switches here. So the 3 edge switches in the pod becomes a failure group, and the 3 aggregation switches in the pod also becomes a failure group. And then we add backup switches per failure groups. So we then use the shaded area here in the graph to illustrate how we insert the circuit switches and backup switches to the network. So first, at the edge layer, we insert the circuit switch between the edge switches and the servers, and we also add one backup switch to the edge switch pool. So in case the edge switch 0 failed, then all the ports that connect to the edge switch 0 then become down, and then we need to reconfigure circuits. So the ports that originally connect to the red dot ports are now reconnect to the black square ports. And then the actual topology becomes this. So the switch 0 is taken offline and completely replaced by the backup switch. And similarly, in the aggregation layer, we insert the circuit switches between the edge switches and aggregation switches. So here, if a link between aggregation switch 0 and edge switch 0 failed, we generally don't have clue which switch actually failed. It could be the aggregation switch, it could be the edge switch, or be both. So Instead of waiting for the diagnosis results, we replace both switches immediately. Again, this is through circuit reconfiguration. So the actual topology becomes this. Both edge switch 0 and aggregation 0 are replaced by the backups. And for the core layer, we need to do a little bit more work. We need to rearrange the core switches and group them in stripes. This is to make sure that all the switches in the finer group have the similar connectivity to the same set of circuit switches. And other than that, the wiring pattern is similar to the edge layer and the aggregation layer. So shell backup adopts the approach recovery first and diagnosis later. So if there's a switch failure, we replace it immediately through circuit reconfiguration. And if it's a link failure, we then replace switches on both sides of the field link. And later, shell backup supports automatic failure diagnosis in the offline. And the details are in the paper, so if you're interested, please go ahead and read our paper. And then with such an architecture, how we do routing? We show that shell backup supports live impersonation of failed switch. So originally in the failed tree network, every switch have its own routing table. So edge switch 0 have routing table 0, edge switch 1 have routing table 1, and switch 2 have routing table 2. But here in shared backup, every switch have a copy of routing table of other switches in its own failure group. So this means that every switch here have all three routing tables installed. And we tagged packets from server with a VLAN ID. So server 0 is originally connected to edge switch 0. So the packet will be tagged with VLAN ID 0. And if somehow edge switch 0 failed, and the traffic from server 0 are all redirected to the backup switch, and then the backup switch will immediately know how to route in the packets from server 0, because it knows that the packet is tagged with VLAN ID 0. So it will use routing table 0 to forward the packets. And then with such an architecture design, we need a control system that controls how the failure recovery works. So we envisage that for such a controller system, it must connect keep alive messages and link status from switches. It reconfigures circuit switches and the failures, and it also performs offline diagnosis. But what's the implication? This means that the control system needs to talk to a lot of circuit switches and packet switches. And you also must keep a large amount of states of circuit, switch, or link status. So this is not scalable. To solve that issue, we develop a distributed control system. We employ one controller for one finer group, and the controller will be responsible for configuring the circuits that are adjacent to the switches in the group. And each controller only maintains a small amount of local circuit configuration states, so they all independently of each other, and they don't share states with each other. And the controllers talk to the circuit switches using an out-of-band control network. So in summary, shell backup provides fast failure recovery, and the recovery speed is as fast as the underlying switching technology. And it supports live impersonation. Shell backup doesn't need to update the routes on switches under failures. The traffic is redirected to backup switch in the physical layer. And switches in the failure group all have the same routing table. And we use VLAN ID for differentiation. Regular switches recover from failures become backup switches. So there's no need to change their role. So with that, we claim that shell backup provides fast failure recovery. It causes no path dilation and no routing disturbance. And then we did test bed evaluation to evaluate the performance of shell backup under failures. So specifically, we use IPERF to evaluate bandwidth advantage, and we run MapReduce jobs to evaluate application level performance and the failures. So in our testbed, we build a cloud network with 8 servers and 12 packet switches, 6 backup switches. So these 8 servers are organized into 2 pods, and each pod has 2 racks. We use a 1 big optical circuit switch to emulate those many small pod count circuit switches. And this figure shows the bandwidth advantage of shared backup and Phineas. We compare it with a global optimal rerouting solution, PodNAND. And the x-axis shows the different failure types. We fail the link at the core layer, at the aggregation layer, and at the edge layer. So we see that at the y-axis is the throughput of individual flows. The blue dots are the throughput of different flows, and the red triangle is the average throughput. So we see that regardless of the failure location, shared backup has no difference with the no failure case. All of these flows can achieve line rate. But if we fail a call link or aggregation link, PodNAND will experience some throughput degradation for some of its flows. And we can see that the throughput variance is very high. And things become even worse if we fail the edge link. There will be a flow throughput that drops to 0. Because if the edge link failed, then the server will be disconnected to the network. So with that, we claim that shared backup restores network to full capacity regardless of the failure locations. And then let's look at the application level performance. We run a MapReduce sort job with 100 gigabytes input data distributed across 8 servers. And in this experiment, we compare shared backup with PodNAND, the optimal global rerouting, and F10, fast local rerouting. We see that if we fail one network link, whether it's been an aggregation link or edge or core link, PodNAND and F10 is generally 20% slower than shared backup. And if we fail edge link, then PodNAND and F10 becomes 400% slower than shared backup. So we say that the performance advantage of shared backup is more obvious in the edge layer, because in this case, the servers are completely disconnected to the network, and all the mapper jobs or reducer jobs on those servers become lost. And then the MapReduce framework will have to relaunch those workers somewhere else. And this will cause significant delay to the application completion time. So with that, we claim that shared backup preserves application performance under failures. So with all those significant performance improvement, we also showed that extra cost of shared backup is actually very low. Since we use small pod count circuit switches, these devices are very inexpensive. So for example, if it's a cross-point switch, then the pod cost is only $3. And we use a very small backup switch pool. So previous study shows that the individual device in the network are actually very reliable. So normally, one backup per failure group is usually enough. And a quick calculation on K equals 48 factory with over 27,000 servers shows that the actual network cost is actually less than 7%. And finally, shared backup supports partial deployment. And as we have shown in the experiments, the failures are more destructive at the edge layer. So the network operators have the freedom to employ only backup at the edge layer for top rack switch failures. Okay, so in conclusion, shared backup is an architecture solution for failure recovery. It uses circuit switching for fast failover. It is an economical approach of using backups in the network. And most importantly, it preserves application performance under failures. And we think the key takeaways from this talk is that first, rerouting is not only is not the only approach for failure recovery. And second, fast, transparent failure recovery is possible through careful backup placement and fast circuit switching. Thank you.
Thank you. I have to go to the stage. All right, questions? Yeah.
Hello, Danny Chen from Princeton University. Thanks for the bullet work. I really like the idea. Can we go to slide 22?
22.
Yeah, so my first question will be, when the edge link fail in usual topologies, the server will get disconnected. But in this case, in the shared backup setting, only one server only have one link to the backup circuit switch, is that right?
Yes.
So in that case, when the link fail, you should also get a zero throughput on that server. Why not show here?
For shared backup?
Yes, so if the link from the server to the shared backup circuit switch also fails in this case, you should also get a zero throughput, is that correct?
In shared backup, we also have a backup switch for the top of racks. So here, if an edge link failed, then it's not the server's fault, it's the top of rack switch's fault. So we redirect the link to another backup tor. So it will resume the throughput.
I see. So you added a lot of resources, including from the tor to the backup. So in this case, I wonder if you performed the evaluation for the like Portland or F10, with them using the extra backup resources just as normal resources. Because if you have like three switches using the shared backup, you should give four switches to the other settings. And they should have a higher throughput than you do, right?
Yes, that's a good question. So we have considered about that problem. So if you add more switches in Portland F10, there's generally no straightforward solution to incrementally add more switches. And if you use those switches for production traffic, then under failures, those switches will experience throughput degradation. So instead, in shared backup, we keep the backup switch idle most of the time. And if there's a failure, then we migrate traffic to the backup, so it will resume throughput.
Yeah, so just a quick comment. This what looks like you have a network with 100% capacity, but you run at 75%. This way you create some headroom.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. We over-provision network.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Okay, yeah.
Next talk, we buy from Microsoft. So my question is, how do you handle the failures of the circuit switch?
That's a good question. So there's a concern that since shared backup uses a separate control network, so if the circuit switch or the control channel failed, then the circuit switch will become unresponsive. And if it's only a software failure, then the circuit switch will keep the existing circuits. So the data plane is not impacted. But if there's a packet switch failure in the future, then we'll have to fall back to rerouting because the circuit switch is not functional. There's no flexibility to reconfigure it anymore.
Okay. I see, thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, Arseniy Zasranykh, EPFL. Thank you, that's interesting approach. I'm not very familiar with the area, so I had a question when you estimated the cost about 6.7%. Overhead. How much does it give? How much does it improve reliability, availability of the network? Do you have a quantitative estimation, or maybe you've done an experiment?
So for reliability improvements, I think this can be shown by the application performance under failures. So if here in this graph, we shows that if we fail one link, then both Portland and F10, these are basically the state-of-the-art rerouting solutions, will experience serious throughput degradation. And the job completion time will be much, much larger. And so let's only look at the edge case. If there's edge link failure, shared backup is four times faster than F10 and Portland. So the performance improvement is worth the actual 7% network cost investment.
Okay, let's thank the speaker. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, and we move to the second talk for this session that is going to be given by Li Chen. He just graduated from the Hong Kong University of Science and Technology, and he's currently working in the data center networking team of Tencent. And he's going to talk to us about deep reinforcement learning in data centers.
So, can you hear me? Okay, thank you for the introduction. And today I want to talk about how to use deep reinforcement learning to do traffic optimizations in at the scale of data centers. So we call our system Auto, and this work is done mostly in Hong Kong USD and with Justinus Lingus, Kai Chen, and Feng Liu from SKIC Motors. Okay, great. Great. So before we talk about AI, let's look at how we do traffic optimizations now. So definitely we'll start with traffic data collection. For that, we must deploy a monitoring system. And then after we collect enough data, we'll present it to the engineers so that they can perform data analysis and incorporate their application layer knowledge and produce a heuristic. And they test their heuristic using simulation tools and find out what is the optimal parameter setting using optimization tools, perhaps. So usually it takes weeks or months for an engineering team to produce a traffic optimization system or policies. And let us look at a concrete example. And this is our previous work, Pierce, and it appears in NSDI 2015. So Pierce is an information agnostic flow scheduler, and the entire process to produce Pierce is just like what we saw in the previous slide. And first, we find the traffic characteristics in large production data centers as well as academic papers. And then we combine our application layer knowledge and decide to use multi-level feedback queues. And as a quick spoiler, this is also an essential part of Auto, and I will describe its mechanism in detail later. So we also formulated an optimization problem to find the optimal threshold settings. And finally, after about 6 months, we finally finished Pierce. And Pierce can reduce the flow completion time without knowing the flow sizes. But it still has many issues, and the most important ones are the following. So the first problem is the data staleness. It means that the traffic distribution that we build our system on is actually different from the traffic distribution that the system is finally deployed in. And even when the two distributions are the same, we still cannot avoid temporary mismatch between the system parameters and the environment. And this mismatch, when it occurs, it can cause performance degradation as much as 40%. So we should know that this is not unique to Pierce, and many other flow scheduling work or other traffic optimization schemes also have this problem that their environment, their parameter does not fit the environment. And we believe that both problems can be avoided or even mitigated, or mitigated at least if we reduce the turnaround time from months to seconds. So basically, how do we do that? So our goal is to reduce the turnaround time, and the obvious first step is to move the human beings from the control loop. And the hope is that we can automate the entire process with artificial intelligence so that it can finish the loop, entire loop within seconds, and the traffic optimization policy is always in sync with the traffic distribution. So let's look at the problem that we are trying to solve with AI first. This is a typical data center network which hosts many applications, and the communication between the application instances will create network flows. So traffic optimization is basically dynamic control of the network flows to achieve some performance goals. And like many other work in this space, we also focus on minimizing the flow completion time. And this is a very large scale online decision making problem because a typical data center can contain tens of thousands of servers, and on each server there could be thousands of concurrent flows. So the subfield of AI that deals with control problems like this is called reinforcement learning, and we believe that this is the AI for the job. So basically, RL is trying to map the situation, find the optimal mapping from the situations to the actions. And recently, we have seen many success stories of deep reinforcement learning in solving complex and difficult sequential decision-making problems, such as playing Go or managing power systems in large data centers. Deep RL is basically the combination of reinforcement learning with deep learning. Reinforcement learning basically provides the conceptual framework for us to model the control problems, and deep learning provides us with two things. The first one is the expressive and multi-layer deep models so that we can express and represent the complex environments. And the second thing is the end-to-end training mechanisms, basically the backpropagation, so that we can train this kind of deep models end-to-end. And with deep models, we can allow the reinforcement learning to solve complex and difficult control problems end to end. And let us first overview reinforcement learning. And it is a very general framework where an agent will interact with an environment. At each time step, the agent will obtain a state observation from the environment. And based on its own policy, which can either be stochastic or deterministic, it will produce a action that will take effect on the environment. And the environment will return a reward signal, RT. And then the environment will transition to the next state based on its own transition dynamics. So the goal of the RR agent is to maximize the expected reward. And in terms of traffic optimization, basically in each time step, we expect the RL agent to collect the flow states from all the of all the flows, and then produce an action for every active flow and update the policy based on the reward obtained from the environment. We'll look at one aspect of flow optimization as a concrete example, which is flow scheduling. And to apply RL, we start by making a few simplifying assumptions. We assume the network is running strict priority queuing in all the switches and for all the flows. And then the network is well load balanced. So the problem of flow scheduling only becomes a problem of assigning priorities to the network flows. And the policy gradient algorithm is very suitable for this task. So in each time step, the RL agent will observe a state, take an action, and update the policy based on the rewards. And we define the states as the collection of all the active flows and all the finished flow in the current time step. And the action space is basically the number of priorities supported in the network. And we define the reward function as the ratio between the normalized throughput of consecutive time periods. So in each time step, we will update the policy based on this formula. And basically, we are training the neural network data using this formula. Basically, we are just adjusting theta in the direction of the gradient that maximizes the expected reward, J. Okay. So does this RL model work at the scale of data centers? We definitely need to perform an experiment to find out. So in this experiment, we use the simplest neural network with only one hidden layer, or one input layer and one output layer. So we implement the policy gradient algorithm using popular reinforcement learning frameworks, and we set the flow arrival rate at 1,000 flows per second, which is extremely low for any data center. And we measure the response latency for the updates. We can see that the processing delay is more than 60 milliseconds. To put this into perspective, on a 1 gig link, any flow less than 7.5 megabytes would have finished when the actions came. So a 7.5 megabyte flow is actually larger than 95% of all the flows if we take a trace from the Microsoft production data center. So basically, it tells us that this is too slow, and most of the deep RL actions are basically useless because the short flows are already gone when the actions came. So our initial plan is to take humans out of the loop, but the experiment told us that even with humans out of the loop, the deep RL processing is still too slow. We also need to move the deep RL processing out of the critical path in the data plane. The question is how? And to answer this question, we must go back to the well-known characteristics of the data center traffic. And here we only look at two figures from the famous DCTCP paper, but the same characteristics are also echoed elsewhere in many other papers. The first one is the interarrival time of flows. Basically, we can see that the short flows will come and go quickly, while the long flows will appear less frequently. And the second one is the PDF distribution of the flow size and distribution of the total number of bytes sent by flows of different sizes. We can see that most flows are short flows. But the most of the bytes are actually sent by long flows. It means that although small in number, the long flows are more impactful. So to summarize, for data center traffic, we have two types of flows, the short ones and the long ones. And for the long ones, because they have more bytes to send, they are relatively tolerant of the DRL processing delay. And because they are more impactful, they also should be, they can be and should be processed centrally. But for majority of the flows, they are shorter ones, and we must handle them at the end host to avoid the control delays. So to handle them at the end host brings about three challenges. First is that how do we define short and long flows? We expect the criterion to be dynamic and adaptive to the traffic variations. And the second challenge is how do we choose a scheduling mechanism that can minimize the FCTs while tolerant of the DRL processing delays? And lastly, how do the end hosts keep up with the global traffic dynamics? So our experience from peers tells us that the multi-level feedback queuing can actually address these three challenges at the same time. We previously designed peers for the flows without sizes when they start to send, and it works like this. So every flow will start at the highest priority, and it will send packets tagged with the highest priority until alpha 1 bytes are sent. And if there are still bytes to be sent, it will be sent in the second highest priority until alpha 2 bytes are sent. For really long flows, it will descend down to the lowest priority and send its packet there. So peers approximates shortest job first. If you look at the flow level movements, the short flows will finish quickly at the highest priorities, and the long flows will finish at the lowest priority, will drop down naturally to the lowest priority and finish majority of its bytes there. So we can see that multi-level feedback queue can separate the short flows and the long flows quite naturally. And in terms of thresholds, we previously formulated an optimization problem. Good thing about this is that the threshold optimization and update is running parallel to the flow scheduling, so it is very tolerant of the DRL processing delay. And the threshold update is also generated centrally with global information, which means that it can adapt to traffic dynamics. So going back to our initial plan of moving humans out of the loop, with multi-level feedback queues, we now have the mechanism to also move a deep RL out of the critical paths in the data plane. So this is a very high-level view of auto. Using the SDN lane goals, we have three planes. In the management plane, this is where the human lies. The humans will come up with the high-level directives, and in the case of auto, the directive is to reduce the FCT. And the deep RL algorithms lies in the control plane. And we call the software running there the central system. We'll take the traffic statistics collected from the end host monitoring modules and output the traffic optimization policies in terms of parameter settings to the end host enforcement modules. And in the data plane, and we mean specifically the end host data plane, we have two modules. The monitoring module will report the flow information to the central system, and the packets of the flow are only affected by the enforcement module. So this is how auto achieves scalability by taking humans and DRL algorithm out of the critical path. So this is a simple example of auto with four queues. So using multi-level feedback queue, the end host makes per flow decisions quickly with the thresholds and the byte sent for each flow. So for four queues, we need to compute three thresholds, and we use a DRL agent running DDPG algorithm to generate the thresholds. And for the flows in the last queue, they are long flows, and we use a different DRL algorithm called, which we've seen earlier, is policy gradient. And we set the route, the rate, and the priority individually for each long flow, because they are the more impactful ones. But in practice, we find out that setting rate is actually quite harmful because of the control latency due to work conservation. And instead, we leverage the transport layer protocols such as DCTCP to do that. Added benefit of using DCTCP is that congestion control and things like incast mitigation are also handled. So So next, we'll look at the peripheral system at the end host in more details, which has two modules, as we just mentioned, monitoring and enforcement. We use the short flow operations to demonstrate how it works. The enforcement module will run multi-level feedback queue and tag the packets using the DSCP field according to its queue using Linux TC interfaces. It updates a shared data structure called a flow table, and the flow and the data structure is shared with the monitoring module. The monitoring module will take a snapshot of this data structure and report back to the central module, which will collect all the flow level statistics and compute the thresholds using DDPG algorithm. And then it will adjust the threshold at the enforcement module by sending a set of thresholds there. So we'll move on to the evaluations. We'll use a testbed of 32 servers and two switches, one for data plane and one for control plane. And we use traffic generators to generate flows and two flow size distributions from production data centers. We compare with the heuristic with fixed parameters. Because we have four priority queues in the network, we use quantized version of the shortage offers and quantized version of least attained service, basically peers. So we first look at the end-to-end performance. And in these experiments, we vary the flow size distribution of the traffic every hour, as well as the load percentages and the server groups that is generating the traffic. And here we collect the flow completion times, and we plot the average flow completion time, as well as the tail flow completion time, the 99th percentile. We have two observations. First is that for the fixed parameter heuristics, we can see that when their parameter mismatches the environment, the performance of the heuristics will suffer greatly, as indicated in the black circles here. And secondly, we can see that auto is improving with respect to time. In the 8 hours of running auto, it can learn and adapt to varying flow size distributions, and in the last hour, can even outperform the other two schemes. But this really is a very simple topology, and the problem that we care about the most is still the scalability, and next we will look at how scalable is auto really is. So we look at the short flow RL agent first. Because we need to produce threshold in the continuous space, we use the deterministic policy gradient algorithm. This is an off-policy actor critique algorithm, which means that in the control loop, we only have the actor's neural network, which have deterministic inference latency with only two fully connected hidden layers. The critique network is updated in parallel, so it does not affect the processing delay. And in the figures below, we measure the response delay in the experiments on different servers in four runs, and we find out that the short flow RL agent can respond to an update within 10 milliseconds on average. And the number of short flows does not impact the deep RL processing at all because of multi-level feedback queues. Next, we will look at long flows. The action space is discrete because we only need to select the priority and the route for each of the long flows. We can use the policy gradient algorithm because of that, and this is unfortunately an on-policy algorithm. So the number of long flows does impact the DRL processing, and we perform experiments to find out how much is the impact. Basically, we increase the number of long flows reported to the IL agent from 11 to 1,000 per time step per server, which we think is large enough for current data centers. And we find that the response delay only go up from 36 milliseconds to 81 milliseconds. And in the future, it is possible that a server can have much more long flows. So we also outline a few possible future improvements here, including making it offline or making the algorithm asynchronous, basically applying the A3C algorithm. Or we can use the computational capacity of the processing cluster to adjust the last threshold that distinguish between the short flows and the long flows so that we can ensure we always have enough capacity to process the long flows. So let's summarize what we have covered so far. To reduce the turnaround time and keep up with the traffic variations, we try to use the deep RL to move human beings out of the control loop. But our experiments show that the processing latency of current deep RL systems are simply too high. And we need to move deep RL out of the critical path in the data plane. And we design Auto to do exactly that by exploiting well-known characteristics of data center traffic, basically using multi-level feedback queues to separate the short flows and the long flows, and using different deep RL algorithms to process them individually. So we believe that this is the first step in automating traffic optimization in data centers. And with that, I'm ready to take questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Questions? Yeah.
Hi, this is the next talk. This is Mo Wei from Tsinghua University, China. It seems that you learn it online, right? So
yep.
Did you use a simulator to get a warm start or just train it from the beginning?
We didn't use a simulator because we are running the experiments in the academic data center. We actually control all the machines. So we directly use the flow generators to train the RL agents. Yeah.
So how long will it convert to an acceptable performance, since if you run this algorithm on a commodity data centers, it may hurt the performance during the start phase?
Yes, I agree with that. If you run this with the production traffic, definitely you need to have some safety measures to prevent and to isolate the traffic that we're experimenting with. Our experience is that the convergence is depending on the hyperparameters of the algorithm and definitely about the algorithm itself. For example, in the DDPG algorithm, we only have two hidden layers for the actors model. For the actors neural network and the three hidden layers for the critiques in neural network. We found that in practice, this helped us to converge quite quickly. And I think if you are working on a different problem, definitely you need to tune the hyperparameters to ensure, to find the combination to ensure convergence.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
The other question there?
Hello, my name is Patrick Kalmbach from TU Munich. I understood that the main part of your work is basically this dynamic adaptation of those threshold values. And now my question is, given the traffic mix at the current time step, is deep reinforcement, or what is the advantage of using deep reinforcement learning to find those thresholds compared to, for example, an ILP or another heuristics? What is the advantage of using deep reinforcement learning only to find those threshold values?
Can you repeat the last part of the question? What are you comparing deep reinforcement learning with?
What is the advantage of using deep reinforcement learning to find those threshold values compared to alternative methods that do not rely on deep reinforcement learning, like traditional techniques like ILPs or heuristics or approximative algorithms?
I think this is an important question. Basically, can we optimize the algorithm that come up with the thresholds, maybe ILP, to a point that it can finish between time steps? But the problem with that is that previously we all already have the optimization problem for generating thresholds for peers. But the problem with that is that it is not really optimal because we are making a lot of simplifying assumptions about the problem. For example, we assume that the network is a big switch network. It's a big switch, so that there's no congestion and it is a bisection. It has bisection bandwidth, which is usually not true. And the second one is that we use MM1 queuing assumptions, which is definitely not true in data center environments. So. Even we call this a optimal the optimization problem, it is not really optimal, and we are operating at a very abstracted layer so that the algorithm can run quickly. The advantage of using deep RL is that it can model the complex environments of data center networks, and then we can stop worrying and learn to trust the machines. Maybe we can take this offline and we can discuss more. Thank you.
Maybe one last question. I'm really sorry.
So Danny Chen from Princeton University. Thanks very much for the great presentation. So I have two very technical questions here. So first, what was the size of the network you used at the end of the day? Do we really need deeper network, or can we try to use more simple and smaller network and make it still work?
Well, definitely. Like I just said, the actor network and the critique network is two or three. It's not really It's not really deep, actually. But but the number of neurons is, I think it's a 300 neurons per layer. So I think this auto is already an example of that we are not using really deep networks, but we are achieving good performance. But in terms of long flows, we actually use a 10-layer network. And using 10-layer network, we find that it helps us to achieve better performance. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you again. All right, so we move to the third talk for this session that is going to be given by Florian Wolfhard. He's at TU Munich. He's a sixth year PhD student, and he told me that he's actually looking for a job, but only in Munich. So if you're not in Munich, that's not an option.
All right, thank you, Dina. I did this work as part of an internship with Akamai, and this is a joint work with my co-authors, Nikos, Jagler, Georg, and Walter. We discovered that there was recent interest in the serving infrastructures or the peering edge of large content providers. For example, in last year's SICOM, there were two papers, the Espresso paper by Google and the Edge Fabric paper by Facebook, that were interested in the serving infrastructures. However, they were mainly focused on designing scalable systems for traffic engineering at the serving infrastructure and not describing the service and the serving infrastructure itself. And that's why we think that there's actually unknowns in the size and structure of service infrastructure of large content providers, and that's why we look into this as part of, we look into Akamai service infrastructure as part of one example of a large content provider. There's two pieces to a service serving infrastructure. The first one is the footprint, that's the machines, clusters, and deployments, the physical hardware that we have, and the connectivity fabric, this is the peerings with other networks, how the deployments are interconnected. I want to highlight three of the findings from our paper. The first one is that there's two different kinds of peerings, and the implicit peerings, they cannot be observed from public BGP data. Second, Akamai heavily relies on deaggregated prefixes, so that's not only /24 network prefixes, but also more fine-grained network prefixes matter. And we have a shift. We observe a shift towards the private internet and the heavy use of private links between large ISPs. Our approach was to first describe and quantify Akamai serving infrastructure in terms of footprint and connectivity fabric, and then show some examples of how Akamai uses its serving infrastructure or connectivity fabric in particular. Let's have a look at Akamai's deployments. They are either located at a co-location facility or located within a hosting network. And this means that Akamai's clusters, server clusters, they're located either in a co-location that's where Akamai operates the network, or inside a hosting network. And we will first have a look at deployments from the second category, where a deployment is within a hosting network. The typical example, the traditional example, is that a deployment is located within an eyeball network. This means the servers are actually located very close to the end users. However, these deployments can only serve a fraction of the end users, namely the users in the eyeball AS, and also depending on whether there are downstreams available to be served, the downstreams of this eyeball AS network. On the other hand, we can there are servers deployed in transit networks. In these transit networks, these deployments can serve all the end users, so there's no restriction from that side. However, these are not located as closely to the end users as in the eyeball networks example. So these are the two traditional types of deployments for Akamai, but there are also, so first of all, I want to give these two types of deployment names. The one in the eyeball network we call on-net deployment because the deployment sits right where the eyeball, where the end users are. And the second type, obviously, it's the transit type of deployment. Now, let's go over to the Akamai deployments at a colocation facility. There, Akamai operates its own AS with the public peering AS of 2940. Typically, so this is a newer type of deployment, which very large deployments with many, many more servers than the two I just showed you before. And these come with a router to connect the deployment to the outside world. And what is the outside world? This is, there's two different cases. The first one is that the deployment is co-located at an IXP. And the second one, that it's co-located, that is not co-located at an IXP, and it uses private network interconnects, PNIs, to connect to other large, typically large networks. This can be content providers or eyeball networks. We call them IXP or Type 3 deployment on the left-hand side and PNI deployment on the right-hand side. So to sum it up, we have introduced four different categories or types of deployments that we see in the network. These make up more than 85% of all the deployments that Akamai operates. So of course, the deployments are not homogeneous, they are heterogeneous, but we can group the deployments, we can group most of the deployments, more than 85%, into these four categories. There are also other types of deployments with other types of workloads. For example, there is an Akamai BGP collector that ingests BGP streams from the Akamai routers and also from the hosting networks. And I will not, so we will rely on data that is coming from these Akamai BGP collectors as part of our study. However, I will not go into detail about the Akamai BGP collector. They are part of what's feeding the mapping system, and there was a paper at SIGCOM 2015 if you're interested in the Akamai mapping system. We've talked about deployments and types of deployments. Now we want to look at how these deployments are interconnected with other networks. And we'll start off with the IXP and PNI types of networks because they're straightforward. That's the traditional way of peering. Akamai is one of the peering partners, and it uses its border router to establish BGP sessions with other peer, either at the IXP or via PNIs with its PNI peers. We do call them explicit peerings because we want to distinguish them from a second type of peering that I will introduce later. When looking at our BGP data, we find that Akamai has more than 6,000 explicit peerings with other AESs. This means that more than around 10% of all the routable AESs on the internet are peering with Akamai. We can break this number down by IXP or PNI, and we find that there are many more explicit peerings learned from IXP deployments compared to PNI deployments. This is not surprising, since we find that there are many networks peering at IXPs, and there's only a few large providers that Akamai connects to via PNI. And that's also what we observe when looking at the statistics of per deployment. So we can see many more explicit peerings per deployment for the IXP type and less than 10 for the PNI type. Now let's move to the second type of peering. We will go back to the on-net and transit deployment types. And Akamai is a guest inside a host network, so it's not involved in peering at all. However, the host network has peering sessions with other networks. For example, in the on-net, in the eyeball network case, it could be the downstream networks, and a transit network is usually a large network that's well connected and has many, many peerings. So as Akamai sits within these networks, it can make use of the deployments from the host network. And all the IaaSs that the host network peers with are one hop away from an Akamai deployment. So that's why we do refer to these peerings as implicit peerings. And we find that the number of implicit peerings is actually substantially larger than the number of explicit peerings. So 28,000 implicit peerings, that's almost half of all the routable AESs on the internet that are reachable within one hop from an Akamai deployment. We can also break that down by deployment type. There are many more learned from on-net deployments in an eyeball AES compared to transit AESs. However, if we look into the number of deployments, the number of peerings learned per host AS, then we obviously observe that transit networks, type 2 networks, are much better connected. So we observe a median of 1,000 implicit peerings per transit network and only a median of 10 per on-net network. However, there are many more on-net deployments and networks than there are transit deployments and transit networks, and this is how this solves. To sum up, we have quantified the number of explicit and explicit peerings that Akamai uses. There was previous work by my colleagues that looked at IXP traffic, where they found traffic flows that used implicit peerings, but they could not quantify. Now we have the ground truth. Now we can quantify the number of explicit, and we find a larger number of implicit peerings than explicit peerings. Up next, we want to show that these peerings are also relevant. They are not only there, but they are also used by Akamai. So in addition to our BGP data set, we introduce another data set, a data plane data set. So these are server-side logs from Akamai servers, and we combine these two data sets to compute the usage of paths learned via different these AS peerings, the AS paths, I'm sorry. So what I want you to focus on is the right-hand column. So the bar width encodes the traffic volume that we see. And this is obviously the widest bar with the most traffic volume. That these are the AS paths that are learned via both implicit and explicit peerings. And this bar is much larger than the other two. So this means we can conclude that both types are very relevant for Akamai and for serving traffic. Next, we go on to the aggregated prefixes. And again, we introduce another data set. So in addition to the private or the proprietary Akamai BGP data, we rely on public BGP data, namely the route views, RIPE RIS, and PCH data sets. And here we do plot the number of prefixes that we learn in each data set by the prefix length. And it's no surprise that in the public data, we mainly find prefixes up to a length of 24. However, what's surprising is that we learn that Akamai learns many more prefixes from slash 25 and even more fine-grained. So what's the purpose of these very fine-grained prefixes? These are prefixes that ISPs, eyeball networks, forward to Akamai in order to steer traffic. And this benefits both parties. So we get a better performance if we have more fine-grained knowledge about the topology of the ISP network, and also the ISP gets control over which users are served in which way. I want to conclude with some food for thought. So let's have a look at the following scenario. A content owner utilizes a cloud provider to store its content. Then there's a CDN that fetches the content and transports it across its private backbone network. And finally, the CDN delivers the content to eyeball networks via private interconnects. So what we observed is there's no public internet infrastructure on this path. So there's no ISPs, no IXPs used. And this makes it harder to study for network research. That's not only hypothetical, there's also some evidence for this shift towards the private internet that we can observe. So first of all, Akamai does indeed connect with cloud providers and large ISPs via private network interconnects. And these are large network interconnects, these are not small ones. There, Akamai does operate its own private backbone network. This was announced last year at the NANOC meeting. And I have one last figure, is that Akamai mainly serves via its on-net and PNI links. That's the largest chunk of the traffic. What you can see here in this figure is, again, the bar width encodes the traffic volume that we see. And this is an example of one specific country that you see. So, of course, this varies by location, and for other countries, it might be it's a little bit different. However, the overall message holds true, not only for a single country, but for the overall delivery traffic of Akamai, that PNIs and on-nets are the ones delivering most of the traffic. I want to conclude with the summary that Akamai relies on both explicit and implicit peerings to serve its traffic. The traffic is steered via very fine-grained network prefixes, more fine-grained than we can find on the public data sets. And we observe a shift towards a private internet, and we have also gathered some evidence for this shift. This study is based on proprietary data. So it's not easy to replicate this data, this study. Some of these problems might be impossible to study with only using public data. However, we argue that once the knowledge is out there and you know what to look for, then it's easier to find ways to reproduce such findings without using proprietary data. So this would be the future research question that I would like to pose here. Thank you. That concludes my talk.
They have to see me first. Thank you very much again. Any questions from anyone? Actually, you were very fast. Yeah.
Engar Fastly, also known as the better Akamai. that was a joke.
Should I respond to that?
the slide before this one that you showed. Yep, that one. I was surprised to see the on-net traffic. Oh, I guess maybe I don't fully understand the graph here. I don't fully understand how much traffic is served via on-net devices versus other ones. That's the first question. And the second one is, do you have a sense for how much performance difference there is for the user when they do not have the PNI versus using other public peering instead of just using PNI?
Okay. So I do not have a global data set over all the Akamai's traffic. What I do have is some case studies, and this is one example for it. So in this case, we studied the traffic that is served by the top five ISPs in one specific country. And so these are the particular results for one country. As I mentioned, these results can vary for different geolocations. For example, in some countries, on-net might be stronger, and in some countries, PNI is stronger, and also in some countries, transit is used more heavily than in this example. But I can only leave you with a kind of a vague idea that on-net and PNI is used very heavily. I do not have numbers to put behind this claim. And the second one is in terms of performance. I also have only snapshots and samples to show. I do not have the data of the overall network. So that's all I know is what you can find from the graphs in the paper.
Understood. I guess I was trying to understand whether PNI is here to stay, or if it's something that can be avoided if we could improve the performance of connectivity via public peering connects. But
I think you should you should talk to one of my co-authors who work at Akamai and who know much better than I.
Fair enough. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Any other questions? So maybe I'll ask you a question. So you mentioned that this is a particular view for a specific country. I suspect you know there is a lot of economics that affect the figure that you have here, no? And there is prior work that shows that IXPs in Europe in particular may actually be shown much more volume than on the slide here. So in the country where you studied, if you were to put the cost for delivery the bits, would it be correlated with this figure? So they try to minimize the cost of delivering the different bits plus maybe performance. I'm quite surprised actually that transit is so thin in this slide. IXP, I'm not surprised because of the performance implications, but transit surprises me a little bit.
So you would expect to see more transit?
Yeah.
Okay. So
can you say what country it was?
No, I cannot say that. The thing is that these are the top five ISPs in this country. And what we observe is that IXP and transit, they are usually used to serve the long tail of smaller eyeball networks. So when we only take the top five, the largest networks, then we probably see a bias towards on-net and ISP. But I do not know any economics. I do not know the figures, what this costs.
All right, thank you. Any last questions? Goes once, goes twice. Okay, thanks a lot, Florian. That's okay. All right, and this is the last talk for this session. It's going to be given by Dana Montaseri, if I didn't kill your name. He's a final year PhD student at Stanford University, and he's going to talk about OMA, a receiver-driven latency transport protocol using network properties.
Hello everyone, I'm Benam, and this is joint work with John Osterhout and Yilong Li at Stanford and Mohammad Alizad at MIT. So when we started this work, our primary goal was to get very low latency close to hardware limits for short messages. But we also wanted to get that at high network loads, and also through a design that is practical for today's commodity fabric. So we designed HOMA, and in our testbed implementation, we were able to get 99 percentile tail latency for short messages at 15 microseconds, and that's at 80% network load. And to the best of our knowledge, that's at least 100x better than any published results of a testbed implementation. We also were able to get up to 90% network bandwidth utilization. And the core idea that allows HOMA to achieve this level of tail latency is effective use of network peripherals. And HOMA realizes that core idea through three main mechanisms that are, one, using or assigning network peripherals dynamically at the receiver, two, scheduling packets at the receiver, and three, over commitment at receiver downlinks, which I'm going to explain them in more details in the later in the talk. So, but at this point, you may be wondering this space of low latency transport is such a crowded space, what's new about HOMA? So we designed HOMA for a different environment from previous work. We designed for a data center environment with lots of short messages, tiny messages, and we want to deliver those messages at extremely low latency. Let me explain what I mean by that. So here we're looking at the CDF of message sizes for five workloads that are measured on Google, Facebook, and Microsoft data centers. So if you look at this point on this graph, 90%, 95% of messages in workload 1 and 2 are smaller than 1,000 bytes. In fact, in general, in workloads 1 through 4, majority of the messages are short messages. However, in previous work, usually a message that is up to 100 kilobytes is assumed to be short. So in fact, that workload 5 here is the famous search workload that's been used in previous works. And in this workload, messages up to 100 kilobytes are assumed short. So that's one thing that is different in design of HOMA. And then we also want to achieve extremely low latency for these short messages. And let me explain with an example. So imagine a 200-byte message in today's data center fabric. We should be able to transmit it from sender to receiver in less than 5 microseconds. But unfortunately, such level of single-digit latency is really, really difficult in today's data center transports. And that's because we have to have a really efficient transport mechanism to get this level of single-digit microsecond latency. Again, an example would make things more clear here. Imagine the same 200-byte message that I was talking about is now blocked in the network with a queue of 8 packets. 8 packets at 10 gigabit per second, that's about 10 microseconds. So the message that could finish in 5 microseconds is now finishing in 15 microseconds, and that's triple X latency increase. So if we really want to get this level of latency, we have to have a very efficient transport mechanism. And maybe this type of queuing that we're talking about may not have much effect on a message that is 100 kilobytes, but that's an extreme overhead delay on the short messages. So actually, turns out that this queuing is the main issue that prevents previous work to get this level of low latency for short messages. Generally, in the space of low latency transport, there are two different low latency schemes. There are ones that are using some kind of rate control scheme, like DCTCP, Hall, PDQ, and NDP. They are helpful to achieve, to basically reduce the queues in the networks. But unfortunately, you can't really eliminate the queuing. Therefore, latency increases when you're running your network at high load. The other set of schemes use network priorities. Schemes like PHOST, PIOS, and QJump, they use network priorities, but we'll explain that, unfortunately, they're not really effective in using those network priorities in achieving low latency. The only scheme that we're aware that could actually achieve very good low latency for short messages is PFabric, which uses lots of priorities, and it's not practical for today data centers and requires switch modification. So, in fact, it turns out that when we want low latency, queuing is inevitable. We have to incur a little bit of queuing when we want low latency. And the reason is that when we have one sender and one receiver, we have to allow the sender to blindly transmit at full rate at least a portion of the message. Maybe not the whole message, but a portion of the message. But then if multiple senders all trying to transmit blindly at full rate, at the same time, they can incur queuing in the network. So if queuing is inevitable for low latency, the only way to get great latency is by using network priority. So if, for example, in this example, we put the sender one at a higher priority, then it can bypass the queue, and the longer the message from the sender two will be queued up somewhere in the network. So we get the extreme low latency for sender one that we want. So we need to use priorities, but in order to do that, we have to first understand how should we assign the priorities. To answer that question, we need to see where the queuing is happening in the networks today. In today's networks, usually the core of the network is really there's a lot of bandwidth in the core, and it's really heavily multipass, that congestion is rare in the core of the network. But congestion can still happen at the top of the rack switch near the receivers. When multiple senders, sender one through n, they're all sending at the same time to the same receiver, they can oversubscribe the link to the receiver and create congestion at the top of the rack queue near the receiver. So if that's the place congestion is happening, then the receiver is the right place to assign the priorities and get the low latency that we want. And HOMA is all about effectively assigning priorities to get the low latency that we're talking about. So the way that we do that is by using priorities to implement SRPT policy. And SRPT policy is a kind of scheduling policy that tries to favor the message that is nearest to completion. It's been shown that SRPT will achieve optimal latency for behavior for average latency and very good tail latency for short messages. So basically, HOMA combines three mechanisms, as I described briefly in the beginning, to effectively use priorities. And these three mechanisms are
dynamically assign network priorities by a receiver, which allows to bypass the queues for the short messages. 2 is a receiver-driven packet scheduling, which allows to reduce the queues in the network and generally get good latency for all of our messages. And then a little bit of control over commitment at the receiver downlink, which allows to basically have multiple senders send at the same time to the receiver, and therefore use the receiver downlink as much as possible and get very good network bandwidth utilization. So the rest of this talk, I'm going to talk about these three mechanisms, and then I'm going to cover the evaluation of HOMA. So first is we'll start with the receiver-driven scheduling. Receiver-driven scheduling is very similar in HOMA, it's very similar to NDPNP host. So the goal with this scheme is to basically give the receiver as much power of scheduling as possible without incurring any additional latency. To do so, every sender has to divide its message into two parts. One part will be transmitted blindly, that we call unscheduled part, and the other part will be transmitted only in response to the explicit grants from the receiver, and we call that part a scheduled part. So the unscheduled part will cover the first round trip time of the message, or the first RTT bytes of the message, we call it. And then every time an unscheduled packet arrives at the receiver sends a grant packet that allows transmission of the scheduled packets. The combination of scheduled packets and unscheduled packets allows us to achieve optimal latency when we have one sender and one receiver in a loaded network. So the advantage of this scheduling mechanism is that we can use it to implement our SRPT policy, approximately implement the SRPT policy. And because it gives control to the receiver who's sending to it. So if there are multiple senders trying to send at the same time and competing for the downlink to the receiver, we can always choose the shortest message and only grant that one. So in this example, sender one was sending a large message. All of a sudden, receiver realizes about sender two, which is sending a short message. So stop sending grant to longer message and start sending grant to shorter message. This kind of SRPT using a scheduling mechanism works great when we have long messages. But unfortunately, it's not optimal when we have short messages. And that's because of two reasons which I'm going to explain here. The first reason is what we call preemption lag problem. And that's a problem that happens when we start sending grants to shorter message. We've already committed our bandwidth to longer message. So the packets from longer message are going to arrive, and they're going to cause queuing, and again, increasing latency of short message. And the other reason is the unscheduled packets. As we said, receiver doesn't have any control over the unscheduled packets. So the only way to give them prioritization is to use network priorities, as we talked about. And HOMA uses network priorities effectively and dynamically by the receiver for that top of the rack switch to achieve low latency. So to do so, receiver has to assign priorities for both a scheduled packet and unscheduled packet. For a scheduled packet, priority assignment is real simple. For every grant that we send, we can assign the priority in the grant for that scheduled packet. So grant one assigns priority P1 for its first scheduled packet, for the first scheduled packet of the sender. For the unscheduled packet, it's a little bit more involved because the receiver doesn't have any information about when the sender is transmitting them. So the only way to assign priorities for the unscheduled packet is to give the sender previously like information in the ahead of the time so that it can use for the future transmission. This information, we call them priority cutoff sizes. An example of a priority cutoff size would be, for example, receiver telling the sender, if your message is between 2 kilobytes and 5 kilobytes, use priority P6 for unscheduled packets. And receiver uses some higher priorities for unscheduled packets and some lower priorities for scheduled packets. So now, let's first talk about unscheduled priority assignment. The unscheduled priority assignment, the goal for the receiver is to have equal amount of traffic or balanced traffic among unscheduled priority. And it has to happen in two steps. The first step is that receiver has to measure the incoming traffic and see and assign the number of priority for unscheduled packets equal to amount of priority bytes that are receiving unscheduled packets. So for example, if receiver measures that 75% of bytes are received in unscheduled packets in total, then it assigns 75% of priorities for unscheduled packets. The second step is to create a CDF of message sizes from the measured incoming traffic and find the cutoff sizes that we talked about in the previous slides. The goal is to assign priority cutoff such that shorter messages get higher priority, and again, equal bytes are transmitted per priority level. So the details of this scheme is in the paper. Please refer to the paper for more details. For a scheduled priority, the receiver goal is to adaptively assign priority levels such that whenever a short message arrives, we can preempt a network for that message. The way we do this, we start from the lowest priority P0 and schedule the message at P0. Whenever a short-term message arrives that is higher priority, we elevate the priority to higher priority and use that priority for scheduling. So our initial approach in scheduling messages was very similar to P-host in the sense that we only granted one sender at a time. And that turned out to be problematic in our workloads. And that was because it could cause wasted bandwidths. Let me explain what I mean by that. When we have multiple senders trying to send to multiple receivers, it could be that a receiver grants to a sender, but sender will not respond immediately, will not send a packet immediately. And that means the receiver downlink would be wasted. The example here clears what I'm talking about. So we have two receivers and two senders. And receiver one has two messages, M1 and M3. It chooses one of them, the shorter one, M1, and sends grants for that one. Receiver 2 also sends grant for M2. But now, sender 1 is getting grant for both M1 and M2, prefers the shorter one, and transmit packets for that one. But that basically means receiver 1 bandwidth got wasted because it committed its bandwidth to sender 1, but sender 1 didn't transmit any packet. So our goal essentially is to keep our links busy while also prioritizing the short message. And to do so, we allow receiver to use a scheme we call control over commitment, and basically means the receiver sends grants to multiple senders at the same time, but different priority levels for different senders, with the shortest message at the highest priority. So in the previous example, receiver one is now granting both sender one and sender two, but at two different priority levels. If both of the senders respond at the same time, then the higher priority packets from sender 1 will be delivered, lower priority packets from sender 2 will be queued up. On the other hand, if the higher priority message will not respond, then the lower priority packets will be delivered and a link will be utilized. So in general, we use priorities to ensure prompt delivery of short message, but we also use the buffering that is essential for high bandwidth utilization. So we implemented HOMA on top of RAMCloud. That is a low latency key value store, in-memory key value store that we develop in our group. And we use the testbed cluster of 8 clients and 8 servers with single switch on an Ethernet fabric. And in every experiment, we chose one of the workloads that I showed in the beginning. And each client creates messages from that workload and sends to a random server. The server responds back with the same size of the message. And we ran this experiment, and here is the 99 percentile tail latency results for HOMA under workload 4 at 80% network load. So this plot is a little bit involved. Let me first take a few moments and explain what this plot is showing. On the y-axis here, we're looking at 99 percentile tail latency, but it's normalized by the minimum latency of each message size. So we call that normalized latency a slowdown. A slowdown of 1 is the best number, and lower numbers are better. On the x-axis, we're looking at the different message sizes of workload 4, but x-axis is linear in the number of messages in workload 4, with each x tick at 10% of message sizes. So percentiles of the message sizes are written at the top of the graph. So for example, let's take a point and explain what it means. This point here on the plot means that messages that are smaller than 960 bytes on the x-axis are accounting for 60% of all messages in workload 4, and we're consistently getting a tail latency, 99 percentile tail latency for all these messages that is at most 3 times the minimum latency for those messages. Generally, for 95% of messages in this workload, we're getting triple 99 percentile tail latency. So these results look good, but we wanted to compare against one of the, for example, one of the low latency transports that people use in commodity fabrics today. So we compared against InfiniBand, and the black line on this plot is the results of InfiniBand. InfiniBand is streaming transport, and the results are 1,000x worse than what HOMA can perform. So it was very surprising for us why InfiniBand is performing that bad. So we started to capture the packets and look in the packet traces and figure out why this is going on, what's happening here. It turned out that most of this overhead in InfiniBand is caused by the senders, by head of line blocking at the senders, when a sender has multiple messages to the same destination. So to reduce this head of line blocking, we implemented a different version of InfiniBand that we call InfiniBand multi-connection, and that's the blue line. In this implementation, each server and client are allowed to have infinite number of connections open, and it reduces head of line blocking at the connection level. So the results of InfiniBand multi-connection is much better, but it's still 20x worse than HOMA. And by the way, this InfiniBand multi-connection is not really usable in today's data center fabric because it's not scalable because of a lot of state that we have to keep around for connections. Then this looks fine, but we also wanted to know how different elements of HOMA are contributing in its performance. So we started to shave off the different elements of the design and see how the performance changes. So we implemented a version of HOMA that we call BASIC. BASIC doesn't have priorities, only uses one priority, and doesn't have any control over overcommitment. It uses infinite level of overcommitment. And no surprise, without any surprise, the results of BASIC is much better, much worse than HOMA, and that's because of the queuing delay at the top of the rack switch. Then the question is that if we layer back in different parts of HOMA that we shaved off, how would the results start to look better? So we put back in the control over commitment, and we get HOMA P1, which is similar to BASIC, but it doesn't use infinite level of overcommitment. It uses 7 levels of overcommitment. And we get 3 times better latency comparing to BASIC by doing just control over commitment. And by the way, in this workload, we can't go below overcommitment level of 4, and that's because if we go below overcommitment of 4, we won't be able to get, we're going to waste a lot of bandwidth, and the senders will not be responsive. We can't sustain 80% network load in this experiment. So the next question is that how does more priorities will help us? So we added more priority. HOMA P2 has 2 priorities, and HOMA P4 has 4 priorities. Adding one more priority comparing to HOMA P1 reduces the head of line blocking another factor of 4 and gets tail latency around 5. For HOMA P4 is essentially similar to HOMA with 8 priority in this experiment. So that concludes the evaluation and test bed. We also ran extensive simulation. We compared HOMA against NDP, PHOS, PIOS, and PFABIC. The blue line and red line down there, this is a workload 5 experiment. Blue line and red line down there is HOMA and PFABIC. For short messages, HOMA is performing similar to PFABIC. For longer messages, it's actually beating PFABIC. And that's because queues in the network, when we're using HOMA, are much, much smaller. We don't have any retransmission. Actually, we never saw any retransmission kicking in when we're running experiment. The purple and green lines are from PIOS and PHOST, and they're generally 150% to 400% worse in the tail. And the NDP is the orange line at the top. The reason that NDP looks bad is because it's using fair sharing instead of the SRPT. The rest of protocols are using SRPT. We suspect that if we add SRPT on top of NDP, then we get similar results to PHOST and PIOS. So with that, I conclude my presentation. In summary, we designed HOMA, which is a low latency transport for high network loads. We can achieve 15 microsecond tail latency for short messages. And the key idea about HOMA is effective use of network priorities. And that's the message that we're trying to convey. Using quality of service effectively helps a lot in getting a lot of objectives from the network. So here is the links to the source codes. There's a simulator and testbed implementation in RAMCloud already available on GitHub. We also have two standalone implementations that are currently under development, which one is in Linux kernel and one is a user space RPC. Please stay tuned for those. Any questions, I'd be happy to ask.
Thank you very much.
Kirill Gugan from NGN Networks.
Can you speak up, please?
Sorry?
Can you speak up?
Oh, yeah, sure. So basically, my question is the following. You mentioned that pfabric is impractical since it requires ordering of packets.
A little closer to the mic.
Basically, yes. you mentioned that pfabric is impractical since it requires basically ordering of packets based on remaining flow size. So, and it requires switch modifications. So basically, did you consider basically comparing slightly different approach of pfabric versus your approach? For instance, something like this. You can open a separate queue basically per remaining flow size, and you can actually normalize all your flows upon a number of buckets that you allocate. And in this particular case, you will actually process all your buckets in FIFO order based on your scheduling characteristics. And it will not require switch modification. This is the first thing. The second thing you mentioned that
Let's finish the first question first.
So your question is that did we compare against a version of pfabric that is simplified? Is that?
Yeah, basically you don't need a single queue that order all packets according to remaining flow size, as it is done in original pfabric paper. So you can actually open multiple queues for different.
Unfortunately, we didn't do that experiment. We only compared against pfabric.
I know. So I think it's very, very interesting.
Maybe for the future.
Yeah. And the other one you mentioned.
I will not allow this question because there are many people. If you want, you can come and find the speaker afterwards.
Poster.
One question per person. Yes,
session,
if you can please wait. Sorry to be so, but we have 3 minutes. Who was first? You.
Abdul from ETH Zurich. From your slides, it seems that the slowdown increases significantly with messages above 123K. So can you comment on the idea of prioritizing messages based on their length as opposed to based on whether this is a real-time application that maybe even with longer messages should have higher priority than shorter messages with delay-tolerant applications?
Sure, the SRPT policy is known to have disadvantage of for the last piece of the message, like the largest size of the message in your network when you're running at high load. SRPT is known to have a bad effect. So that's a bad effect for that message. But even comparing to other schemes like fair sharing schemes, I think still SRPT is a much better policy scheduling. But there are ways to help SRPT policy for that last message size, the largest message size, which we can discuss in the poster session.
Yeah, we're back from the Microsoft Research. I'm also the author of Pierce. So I'm wondering how to handle the packet loss.
How to handle packet loss?
Because you have overcommitment, you also allow the flow to transfer bytes in the first RDT without any grant, right?
HOMA was designed for RPC systems. So the way that we, in the paper, we explain how we're handling the packet losses. The way that we handle it is in the receiver side. And so basically, receiver is granting. The granted part of the message, you can always keep track at the receiver and do a faster transmission. For the first RTT, if all of them dropped, then you have to go through a retransmission timer at the sender. But that's only the case if all of the unscheduled packets are dropping from the sender.
Hi, Sophie from Huawei. Thanks for the nice talk. My question is also about the unscheduled packets because the sender doesn't know the exact amount of traffic to send as unscheduled until it receives a grant from the receiver. Am I understanding this correctly?
The idea that we had was that we start from some conservative number, which can be a little bit more than the actual limit, which is one RTT bytes. So the actual limit is one RTT bus. But your question would be that if you don't know what RTT is, how would you start? So you start with a conservative larger number. Because of the priorities, we're going to take care of the queuing that causes. But as soon as the first grant arrives from the receiver updates the sender about all the state that it has to keep for that receiver.
But what if the sender actually sends a very large flow, then it has very low priority, and the receiver will delay its ground, and it just keeps sending the unscheduled packets and cause overflow at
the
receiver.
So the regular number for unscheduled is about 10, 20 kilobytes in today's data center. Even if you have a megabyte flow, you only send 20 kilobytes, maybe 30 kilobytes of that. And then you wait for the receiver to grant you and update you about more states.
Okay, thank you.
Next one, yeah.
Yes, Anu Ghazi from LAMS. So I wanted to ask that if congestion happens at the core, you would need coordination across receivers. So just wanted to know how would...
That's a great question. That's actually one of the limitations that we explained in the paper. So we our big assumption that I explained in the beginning of the talk in the slide 5 or 6 is that we assume congestion in the core is relatively unlikely. So the most of congestion is happening at the top of the rack switch near the receiver. But if the congestion does happen in the core, then the performance of HOMA will be degraded. And that's just something that we have to take a look into for the future work.
Mark Handley. One of the things we did with NDP was to stripe traffic across all the possible paths through the data center because that mitigates this issue of congestion in the core. But a lot of the mechanism in NDP actually helps to deal with the fact that you get massive reordering. What do you guys do about routing through the core? Do you just use one path?
We do exactly the same thing. We spray the packets. I think in NDP you do at the sender side. We didn't do that. We just sprayed in the core itself, in the routers. But we also take care of the reordering in our stack, in the transport and the software. So we always keep packets. We basically keep at the transport layer. We keep the message until the message completed, and then we handed it back to the application.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Anya, you were next.
Anya Feldmann. I'm wondering how much of a change to the application you have to do in order to actually let the networking stack know about the size of the messages that you want to send.
So that's a great question. So, and that's a regular question that we get usually. So if you look at the data center environment today, pretty much 95% of, I don't know, maybe even more, 99% of transmissions already happen in RPC layer. And RPC has to know about the message size in advance. So that's information that's already available in most of the traffics that we see in the data centers. But even if we don't do that, we have to guess the size if you want to implement in kernel. And that's one of our current plans to try to guess the message sizes at the kernel interface in TC, in the socket interface.
Okay, next one. By the way, we are 3 minutes late, so if you want to go to the preview sessions, you can go, but I thought it's an interesting discussion.
Hi, so I'm wondering, is there any sense or is there any effect if the senders somehow learn an optimal message size so that there's essentially no difference between, there's no small size message, or let's say all messages are the same size. What is the effect then?
Then essentially SRPT turns into first in, first out. It becomes a FIFO schedule. So when you have all messages the same size, the one that comes in first, it makes a little bit of progress and becomes the highest priority, and it becomes first in, first out.
So going back to the problem you described as loss of bandwidth, so if all messages mm-hmm. are the same, how do you handle that? I mean,
but one of the packets will arrive first, right?
Okay.
So packets are arriving in order. So one of the packets from one of these messages arrive first, and receiver assumes that one is the shortest one because it just got a packet from it and gives the highest priority to it and becomes first in, first out, which is still, I think, better in terms of latency. It's better than fair sharing.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, sure. Costin?
Yeah. Hi, yeah, really cool work. So it seems to me that the performance of HOMA hinges on getting the priority for unscheduled bytes right. If you get that wrong, then the whole thing collapses. So how do you disseminate this stuff, right? So you could have, you have 100,000 hosts that could send to you at any given point. You're one receiver. You can't just broadcast to everyone, like, you know, this is how much you sent to me. So how do you actually advertise thresholds right. and the priorities?
I think in our design, the plan is to send them back, piggyback them on the available packets. So we're not going to use, when a sender starts that has never talked to a receiver, it starts with some conservative value, like uses the lowest priority possible. And when the first grant arrives, the receiver will start to basically inform the senders about their correct decisions, correct thresholds, or cutoff sizes.
So maybe I'll ask a question. So, we are running a data center that has multiple workloads, and you have two parameters in your scheme, number of priorities and the number of the amount of overcommitment. How much do I have to train this to accommodate multiple workloads at the same time?
Multiple workloads?
Workload 1 plus 5 on this graph instead of a single workload that you managed to extract the ideal parameters for. You see what I'm saying?
That's an experiment that unfortunately I haven't run with multiple workloads. That could be a good thing to think about. But essentially, if you're talking about workload 1 and workload 5, lump them together, you get something like workload 5. And then it practically means you're going to prioritize workload 1 part of this lumped workload, and workload 5 will be dominating still because it has a lot of long messages. Right. And by the way,
what I'm saying is, that at different points in time you have a different mix of those things, and I wonder how much those parameters, the number of priorities and overcommitment, affect the effectiveness of the system.
So receiver sees the cumulative effect of all these sure. workloads. So it makes a new decision, and based on the new workload that it's measuring. That's what currently happens.
Okay. Last question, and then we can all go.
I want to ask about difference of HOMA and p-host. The difference only are priorities for a scheduled parts of flows.
Using more priorities, that's one, and affect and try to effectively use them. And the second part is the overcommitment scheme that allows us to push the network to kind of 90% network load. That's essentially the top-level differences between HOMA and p-host. There are small implementation differences that you can read in the paper, especially in the real implementation that we have in RAMCloud. There's a lot of things that we have to take into account. For example, one of them is a very accurate or precise scheme of rate control for the transmit NIC at the senders. That's one of the things that you have to have, otherwise you will get a lot of performance loss.
Okay, let's thank the speaker one last time. Thank you for running around.
Yeah. Thank you, Dina, for keeping this session on time, at least for our conference standards. So as Dina mentioned, there are topic preview sessions start upstairs about application and IoT and RDMA and hardware support. The speakers, Hamid Hadidi, and Ibojo, so basically that should be pretty good. Also, Wi-Fi works better upstairs, so and the seats are more comfortable, so it's just a hint. Also, since so many people registered last moment and we're really close to the maximum capacity, I think we did pretty good in guessing the t-shirt size distribution, but if you didn't get the t-shirt of the size you wanted, yesterday we ordered some more t-shirts as fast as the manufacturer could provide. So if you want a different t-shirt size, they should arrive tomorrow by midday. So stop by the registration desk. And the speakers of the next session, find Mohammed, test your laptop because the break is short.
Good. Welcome to the third topic preview session. We will start with a presentation by Ahmed Haddadi. He's a senior lecturer from Imperial College London, and he will brief us on applications and IoT. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Thanks and welcome for, thank you for coming to this session in the middle of your break. So I'm going to briefly talk about the common thread in the papers in this session, which is kind of a mixed bag, actually. But the common thread that I could find between them is basically deep learning and IoT. So obviously, if you've been living, as long as you haven't been living in a cave, you will realize that machine learning and deep learning are nowadays making their way into the community. So why is that? It's simply because supervised learning is hard. We cannot tune all these knobs and dials, so we have to move to a more kind of an easier way to train algorithms like they use in the next two papers, which kind of are inspired from the brain, that you see something, your retina sees an image, it's turned into pixels, and there's some sort of edge detection and some sort of feature extraction happening in the first areas in the brain, and then it's passed to the upper cortex that you have this higher level visual abstraction. So we have two papers in this session that they both rely on deep learning for image and kind of gesture recognition. And in both of these cases, you have an image. This is Yoshua Bengio, a very famous deep learning researcher in the University of Montreal. So you're kind of trying to turn that image to a set of bitmaps in your brain. These are basically neurons. The difference between neurons in the brain and the one in computer is that you can think of these as holding values. In a computer, the neurons that we use in a neural net, they hold weights. In the brain, there's a chemical process, of course, happening. So what happens is that at each level, you go from pixelizing this image to tiny, tiny pixels that, in a way, they just hold grayscale values, to mapping it to higher level abstractions and presentations. You kind of go through them, you're looking for specific features, and this all started in the most simpler form by trying to understand what are the contrasting areas, for example, between the gray and white. So you try to understand where is the circle, and for an individual, for a human being, you see, I don't know, a lizard or a cow once, and that's good enough. You get an idea of the cow. You get an idea, because we have more of a, so the idea is that we have a lot of neurons that fire together. We have a lot of neurons that we can launch simultaneously. Unfortunately, at the moment, with the computers that we have, we cannot do that just yet. So these networks like restricted Boltzmann machines or deep belief networks, which we have lots of fully connected neurons, they're very hard to get to. So what we have in computers nowadays, what we do is that we use this thing called max pooling. So we, in a way, we sample different areas of the image, or the data structure that we have. For convolutional neural networks, so the word convolution comes from convoluting. So you keep sliding this little window over different areas of the image in order to form little presentations and understand what's happening in each region. So you have this thing which is the max pooling. So you just choose the maximum number from that little pooling area, and you keep going from this layer to the next. Eventually, you have some sort of presentation which is good enough and small enough to be passed onto a fully connected layer, where you try to map different features of the image to final representations that you have, whether it's a bird or a sunset or a dog, or in the case of gesture or pose recognition and estimation, what's actually the individual doing? Are they walking? Back in the days in the community, if you wanted to look at gesture recognition and things like that, you had to actually use active markers and then track active markers through MATLAB and stuff. I've did years of doing this marker tracking and stuff on sheep and on human being and all sorts of different experiments. It's a tedious project. Many poor undergrad and postgrad students spend their lives tracking markers. It's not the most fun thing to do. So, and the other thing that we can utilize in this process is the process of backpropagation. So depending on the accuracy that you get in your final classification, you kind of feed back to the other layers that, oh, there's a penalty for getting a bird, identifying a bird as a dog and vice versa. You keep feeding that back, eventually you get it right. So a modern convolutional network today looks something like this. You have an image, in the most basic form, it's a character. You have this convolutional subsampling layers which do the max pooling. They slide this thing over it. So in a way, you're going from this very dense set of pixels to kind of the first hidden layer, which is a slight sample of that with the most dominant features. And you are kind of mapping these features to the next stage, and you just move on until you can reach the output layer. So the main metrics of success, which are also used in the two papers that you will see in the session, are precision, which is basically the ratio of how many items you get right versus how many you get wrong, and recall, which is how many of them, how many of the items that you get right are actually in the space of the basically how many relevant items you choose from the sample size that you had. And then the harmonic mean of these two, which is used in this in one of the papers as well, which is the F1 score, which is basically a ratio that determines really between precision and recall what's the average that you get right. Because you you can have very high precision in algorithms, but your recall is high. You get a lot of dogs classified as dogs, but you also miss a lot of dogs, other dogs that you just didn't actually notice that you have other dogs. So depending on the type of dogs that you have. There's a bunch of other metrics that you will see in these papers. The classification accuracy is very similar to precision. The logarithmic loss, basically, it's again very similar to recall. And the area under the curve, which is for binary classification, which is how many of the items in different classes you got right. So in a way, that was a bit quick. So in a way, that's the essence of deep learning that you need to understand the papers that are upcoming in the next session. And then we move on to the other topic in this session very swiftly, because we don't have that much time, which is IoT. What's IoT? As you all know, it's just a dumb thing that you put a chip in it. There's an excellent collection of very amusing images in this Tumblr. We put a chip in it on .tumblr.com. So it's a thing that is connected to the internet. And no matter how much we resist it in this community, and no matter how much we avoid the hype, these devices are enters our home, enters the network. Last year, we all saw the Mirai botnet, bunch of toasters took down a quarter of the internet, whatever. So, and these are a collection of different devices that range from your mobile phone and smart home and all these platforms that are entering your home, your child monitor and things like that, to smart meters and devices that other people are now forcing you in a way to install in your home. And in the lecture that, in the paper that we have in the next session, and that's a random IoT device that somebody is being shot from their toilet. I just found it amusing, so I thought, let it be there. It's supposed to be an IoT toilet that does something. It's apparently blowing hair to dry you. But anyway, let's move on from that swiftly. So a lot of the hype around IoT is because there's a bit of money in it at the moment, but there's also plenty of opportunities and plenty of hard research problems. And they mostly go around, I don't know what happened exactly here, but they mostly go around the optimization and the trade-offs between how much information and utility you want from the device, what amount of bandwidth, CPU, and energy can you afford, and what are the security and privacy implications. In the paper that you will see in the session, they are actually using another microphone in the room in order to help with the noise canceling device that you have, like compared to the noise canceling headphones that you have today, that you just put the headphone and it's got a microphone detecting the noise, and there might be a bit of a delay between them. Maybe you can use the sensors in the environment to give you that bit of a head start in terms of detecting the noise a little bit faster. So that's one of the things that you can do, that with cheap sensors becoming available and with more of this shit that we are putting into our homes, we can really make use of all this extra information that we have available in the environment. And I think the paper presents a very nice result of that. That's the end of that. There's a bunch of papers that we have on my website which is relevant. And yeah, that would be it for me. Thank you very much. Thank you. some time, but if there are any questions.
Perhaps there's a question. Let me thank you a lot.
Thank you very much.
In order to thank you, we have a small gift. Well, you're on the right way. Gabor has it for you. Thanks a lot. Our next presenter will be saying or explaining what RDMA is. If you don't know what it stands for, stay tuned, because Yubo Zhu from Microsoft Research will tell us all about that. Floor is yours.
All right, thanks for the introduction. So, hello everyone, my name is Yubo. Today, it's my pleasure to talk about RDMA and hardware support, which is the session in this afternoon, 4:30. So from application developer's perspective, they all usually see network as a pipe, right? You put data into one side of the pipe and then just take data out of the pipe from the other side. But under the hood, it's much more complicated because the data usually starts from the memory, from one server, right? And in the traditional TCP/IP stack, the CPU needs to take out the data and then split them into IP packets and run the TCP protocol and notify the NIC for each and every packet. And then the NIC will take the packet to send it across the network, and on receiver side, there's a corresponding CPU processing there. So this architecture has been working well for decades until around 5 years ago. And during the last few decades, the Ethernet grew from like 10 megabits per second to 10 gig, which was deployed at Microsoft in 2013. And CPU was well capable of keeping up with this bandwidth growing because there's a Moore's law, basically. The CPU keeps growing faster and faster. However, things changed in the recent years. I took this picture from an actual pre conference working on circuit design. As you can see, in the last few years, Moore's law has come to an end. The performance of CPU doesn't grow as quickly as before. However, the NIC bandwidth still grows exponentially from 40 to 100. Like last year, we already deployed 100 gig network for certain clusters. And then in a few years, we'll go to 400 gig. So the result is that the CPU has started to become a bottleneck. And let's do a very simple experiment. Let's just have one sender, one receiver, connecting with 40 gig NICs, 40 gig switches. And as you can see, when we run the TCP stack, with different message sizes and the y-axis the throughput, when the message size are small, because of CPU overhead, saturates to 100%, so you only get less than half of the line rate bandwidth. And even if we have used large messages, then you still will burn 3 CPU cores just for running the TCP/IP stack. And of course, another problem is the latency. When you have CPU involved, the latency becomes at least 10 to 20 microseconds. And as a side note, these tests are run on Windows machines. But in Linux machines, we can see a similar trend with many different numbers. So the solution to this is hardware offloading. So basically, we take the task of CPU out to run it on the hardware. And the first step is, of course, to offload the TCP/IP stack from layer 2 to layer 4 entirely to the hardware NICs. And the representative solution is RDMA, or remote direct memory access, which I will talk about in details very soon. Also, there are other network stacks that can be offloaded to hardware, like the other middle boxes, load balancers, or firewalls, for example. And well, beyond the offloading network stack, we also look at offloading application logic to smart NICs, to the NICs, like storage replication of transactions. It's one of the paper you will hear in this afternoon. Also, there are proposals for doing the like key value stores on FPGA smart NICs. And even beyond that, we can think even further whether we can offload things to the switches. Right. This also can happen in parallel with offloading to the NICs. So you can also relevant papers like consensus protocols or key value stores or for Hilbert switches. But anyway, so in this preview, since I will talk about RDMA, let's take a deep dive. So what exactly does RDMA do? So this is architecture. The top half is the sender, the bottom half is the receiver. So what the CPU does is only to allocate the memory buffer in the memory and then tell the NIC, say, I want to send this chunk of memory to the receiver at the address B. Okay, from this address A, from this server to address B on the receiver. So then all the rest of the operations are offered to a SNIC, which means the NIC will directly take the DMA data from memory and then split them into packets and then run transport protocols and send these packets across the network. And on the receiver side, the receiver NIC will assemble the continuous buffer from the packets, DMA into the memory, and then just notify the receiver CPU that the transmission is done. So as you can see in this architecture, the actual data flow, the data path, is all offloaded to the NICs, and the CPU is just for setting up the control channel and just signaling, say, I want to do this, and all the rest are taken care of by the NIC. So as a result, the CPU no longer becomes a problem in the RDMA architecture. With the single thread, RDMA can easily achieve 940 gigs throughput in the same test that we run before. And with that, we only have nearly zero CPU overhead, just for the CPU signaling the NIC, I want to do this transmission. And of course, because we bypass the CPU stack, a large major chunk of CPU stack, then we get much lower latency with the RDMA to just 1 or 2 microseconds. But this sounds easy because you may say, okay, we will just re-implement everything previously in the software, and now we implement them in the hardware. But the problem is that it's actually challenging due to different hardware limitations or characteristics. For example, the NIC has very limited on-chip buffer. And every time, that means it's very hard to implement the sending window mechanism by TCP. It can't buffer a large sending window on-chip. And it's very expensive to go back and forth to fetch data from the PCIe. So a solution is that, okay, maybe we design another family of protocols. We don't use TCP window-based protocol, it's read-based, because it's relatively easy to do read limiter in the hardware than doing window-based control in software. You can refer to a previous work about the transport protocol. Another problem is that the RDMA NIC is very hard to deal with the packet drops, because every packet drop, because it doesn't buffer the packet, but doesn't buffer the buffer on chip. So every time when you want to retransmit some packet, it has to go back to a PCI to go back to the memory and then DMA the data out. And this will cause performance hit. So a traditional solution is use PFC. And I'm pretty sure in the talk of IRN in the afternoon, the authors will tell you about the problems of using PFC to PFC basically achieves the lossless network, but it also causes other problems. So IRN says whether we can get rid of PFC but still get a good performance on the RDMA transport. Also, hardware also has other limitations, like it has limited programmability, it's not as flexible as software. It has limited memory, which means it can only keep track of a limited number of reliable flows, because it needs to keep the sequence number of such reliable flows, and this will lead to scalability problems. There are also papers talking about this. But in general, because of these new challenges, unique challenges, we have lots of research opportunities in this field. So let's get back to the big picture and talk about the papers we'll be presenting in the afternoon. So first, as I said before, the transport protocol of RDMA still needs some work. We want to get rid of PFC. So this is one paper. And the second is, since the RDMA NIC now bypasses the CPU, actually the major bottleneck becomes the PCIe bus between the memory and the NIC. So we need to better understand how the PCIe works, how to better leverage PCIe. And also, since this RDMA network goes through switches, we also need to manage the switches. So there is a third paper talking about this. And also, with some new advancement in the storage medium, especially non-volatile memory, now the RDMA NIC can directly write and read storage medium bypassing the storage stack. So RDMA is no longer just a network stack offloading, it's also a storage stack offloading mechanism. And then we will, the paper will tell us about how we can better leverage this to improve an end-to-end storage system. So that's actually the first paper in the section. So it's talking about RDMA plus NVM. It's a new trend of doing storage system. And we basically, I'm on the paper, so so the paper basically will tell you about how to turn the storage replication and transaction operations into RDMA operations so that the both storage stack and the network stack will be all bypassed from the CPU. And the end result will be surprisingly good, it's up to 800 times tail latency reduction. So the second paper, we'll talk about the network transport layer protocols used by RDMA, like how can we get rid of PFC, but still get a good performance. So I'm pretty sure the author of this paper will explain this to you. And the high level question this paper answer or ask is that what's the minimum hardware change? Also, this change has to be feasible on the hardware. What's the minimum change on the hardware can we get rid of PFC and get rid of the requirement of the in-network lossless network? So the third paper will talk about the PCIe study. It's basically a new measurement tool and a new set of measurement results that study how the PCIe throughput and latency will look like if you do different operations. So the final paper is experience paper from Facebook talking about how to manage the switches, because ideally, when we roll out RDMA features, we also need switch support. Like we need to have a separate priority for RDMA traffic that's isolated from TCP traffic. And how do we quickly do this? Well, this paper is not specifically talking about that, but it's in more general way that how we can manage the switch software in the same way as running web services, right? How we can quickly roll out changes, how can we do tests, all these things. So it will be a very interesting talk, and I also recommend you to check out Sonic, which is also open source or switch operating system, just like the FBOSS. So these are two competing solutions, but you can choose to take which one you prefer. So, in general, I would like to summarize this is a very exciting area. There's lots of research opportunities. For example, I will just list a few examples as future work. Like, are we really done with RDMA transport, even with the IRN talk in this afternoon? IRN talk focused on these data center networks, but if we move on to wider network, can RDMA still work? Also, we can talk about new RDMA-based distributed systems. So not just the storage systems, we can look at AI systems or other new hardware offloading mechanisms or architectures. Also, there's an even higher level of question is, in general, as we do more and more hardware offloading for the network stack, what's the good abstraction to do hardware and software co-design? And this will probably depend on different hardware platforms. So I'm wondering whether there is universal abstraction that can identify which is the best to be implemented hardware and which should be the job of software, and how we can expose the maximum programmability but still get the best hardware performance. So this is even future work, like 5 years from now. As I said in the beginning, application developers see network as a pipe of data. And we are, in the past decades, we have been building faster and more reliable pipe. And I want to ask this question, should we build a more intelligent into a pipe. So network no longer becomes a pipe, but it's actually part of the computing architecture. Like I like to say this example, like with the end of the Moore's law, GPU start to shine for some workloads. But in my eyes, network hardware are also good for certain applications, like streaming applications. So can we also do the same, like use network hardware to accelerate some more general application logic? All right, let's see, thank you.
Any question for you?